Recorded Books presents A Night to Remember by Morgan Matson, narrated by Laura Knight Keating. From The Nighthawks, lyrics by Wiley Sanders. It's the best kind of night, one you can't remember and one you won't forget. Stanford University, Alumni Interview Agreement. The below is to indicate that Poppy Pullman has an interview scheduled with Fiona Baskin, class of 99, for Saturday, January 19th, at her home, 76 Long Beach Lane, Crystal Cove, California, at 11 a.m. In agreeing to the alumni interview, the applicant, Poppy Pullman, is aware of the fact that the alumni, Fiona Baskin, will report back to the admission committee about the applicant's fitness for admission to Stanford's freshman class. Any attempt to bully, bribe, intimidate, or otherwise interfere with the alumni's unbiased decision-making will result in the immediate termination of the interview and the application removed from consideration. In order that the interviewer may get a more complete picture of the applicant's life and character, the public social media profiles of the applicant are considered in addition to the formal application materials. In signing, I agree with all previously stated. Poppy Pullman. Chapter 1. I have a great memory. I can tell you what my best friend Brooklyn was wearing last Thursday. Jeans, purple vintage sweatshirt, earrings that she borrowed from me in October and is still pretending are hers. I can tell you what my mom and I had for dinner 3 nights ago. A tofu and broccoli bake that turned out so unfortunately mushy that we gave up 2 bites in and ordered a pizza. And I can tell you without even having to look at my map app, every turn we would need to take to drive to Crystal Cove High in the best time. I can actually do this blindfolded. My other best friend Daisha doubted me and tried it out last month, and when I actually did it, called me a freak of nature, but in a nice way. My memory has always served me really well in school. Even though it's not quite a photographic, I wish, it's in the same ballpark. Names and dates have always stuck with me, which is why, the morning of my Stanford alumni interview, I swing into the parking lot of Sunrise Coffee feeling confident. Well, confident might be too strong, but I'm sure I know every answer that I've prepared for my Stanford interview, and I have every fact about the woman who will be interviewing me, Fiona Baskin, down cold. But even so, as I sit in my car in the parking lot, I pull out my flashcards. After all, it can't hurt to be prepared. This is Stanford. It's been my dream to go to Stanford since before I can even remember. My dad went there, and there is a picture in our hallway of him in his Stanford sweatshirt holding me when I was a baby in a Stanford onesie. Well, it was in our hallway until the divorce. When all the pictures of my dad vanished from view, I took that one, though, and now it's on my dresser. And every time I pass it, it's like it reminds me of what my goal is, what my destiny has been from the beginning. Stanford. And it's not like I'm delusional enough to think simply wanting to go there is enough to get into one of the most prestigious schools in the country. This is in contrast to my mom. She runs Exhale, a yoga and bodywork studio in town, and is a firm believer in the power of manifesting. She thinks that nothing happens until we open ourselves up to the universe and imagine it fully in our minds. Which I'm not opposed to, but I know that manifesting alone isn't going to get me up to Palo Alto. So I've spent the last few years doing everything I can to try and guarantee my spot at Stanford. I'm on track to be salutatorian, maybe even valedictorian, if Ari Lopez, my main competition, doesn't do as well in AP Calc as she's been telling everyone she will. I've been preparing for my Stanford application since middle school. I'm senior class vice president, My list of extracurriculars is flawless. I volunteer twice a month. My grades are as good as I can get them, and I've been working on my personal essays for over a year now. I even play the lute. I don't actually really enjoy the lute, but my college counselor promised me it would help me stand out. So the lute it is. And my mother always likes to point out, if everything else falls apart, I could at least get a job at a Renaissance fair someday, which I don't find particularly comforting. I am not about to leave anything to chance, or up to the universe, as my mom likes to say. The universe is all well and good, but I need to go to Stanford. I glance at the time and get out of the car, quickly checking to make sure my flashcards are in my purse as I head to Sunrise Coffee. It's on the main street in Crystal Cove, called, perhaps unsurprisingly, Main Street. Crystal Cove, California, is a tiny seaside town wedged in between the much bigger and more well-known towns of Newport and Laguna. We're almost like a little hidden secret, and I've always loved it. The stretch of beach with the surfers bobbing in the water at sunrise, the Cape Cod-style architecture, it's a relic of the Crystal Cove's founder's wife hating California and wanting to go back to Massachusetts. Failing to do that, she insisted on a house that would have looked right at home in Hyannisport. And everyone else copied her, and then it just became the thing. I love the ocean breeze blowing across town, and the traditions we have that are just ours, like our surfing Santa parade at Christmas, and the beach cleanup day that takes place every January 1st, unofficially called the hangover cleanup day. Coffee and aspirin are provided, and everyone is encouraged to talk in whispers. And best of all, the beach is only a 20-minute drive away from everywhere in town. And there are just some places that I know I'll miss when, if, when, I'm up in Palo Alto next year. The Shake Shed. It used to be the Shake Shack until the actual Shake Shack came along and threatened to sue, where they make my favorite milkshake, Cove Pizza, and, of course, Sunrise Coffee. I step inside the coffee shop and feel my eyes widen as I look at the line, which snakes back almost to the door. It probably shouldn't be such a surprise. It's a Saturday morning, after all, but the place is packed. People typing on laptops, parents with kids in strollers, groups of friends clustered together and laughing. I scan the coffee shop, but don't see anyone I know. Usually you can count on seeing at least someone from Crystal Cove High here on any given morning, and during finals week, it's like the place is populated by only high school students. There is one person I vaguely recognize, sitting in the back and scrolling on a tablet. Scooter McDonald. We were in chemistry together sophomore year, but we don't really run in the same circles. Scooter is always throwing parties at his dad's beach house, getting grounded for throwing said party, and then once he's in the clear, starting the whole loop over again. I've never been to one of Scooter's parties, but it feels like I have, given the pictures and videos I've seen of them over the years. And seeing what they were like virtually is more than enough for me. The last thing I need is to be tagged in someone's party selfie, sending all my hard work crumbling. Because I don't have regular social media accounts like most of my classmates. I mean, I have all the normal ones, but I post on them very carefully. I've never used them like my friends. I'll sometimes look at their posts and stories in fascinated horror. Don't they realize that someone could find this? What if they want to get into college, or get a job, or be Secretary of Transportation someday? Don't they realize that all their blurry party selfies and unfiltered stories could come back around and cause them trouble? It's too big a risk. So my social media, especially my Instagram, isn't casual or fun like some of my friends' pages. My Instagram is carefully calibrated. A picture of me volunteering, a picture with my friends, a picture of my mom's rolled-up yoga mats arranged by color. If you look at my profile, which I am all too aware that admission committees often do when reviewing applications, all you will see is exactly what I am, a driven and hardworking senior with no drunken nights or crazy escapades, the model Stanford student. Of course, the lack of drunken nights and crazy escapades are the things that Brooklyn and Daisha constantly complain about. But I always tell them there will be time for all of that. Crushes and parties and staying out all night when I'm in college or even business school. Right now, I have to keep my eye on the prize, and the prize is Stanford. But as I take a step forward in the line, I'm glad that Scooter is the only person I recognize, because secretly, I don't actually like coffee. I don't spread this around because I don't want anyone to make fun of me. My mother doesn't understand it. She has the world's fanciest espresso machine at our house, her prize possession. She's always offering to make me a latte or a flat white, whatever that is, but I always tell her no. I don't like the taste of coffee, and I don't like the smell. But I love being in coffee shops. They are my favorite places to study or do homework. Somehow, the noise of everything else around me, espresso machine hissing, couple fighting one table over, the registers ding, means I can really concentrate on my work. When I'm with a group of people and everyone is ordering coffees, I'll get a latte and sip at it and pretend it doesn't taste like burned rubber. But when I'm alone, and when nobody from Crystal Cove High is around to hear me, I always get a hot chocolate extra whip, extra chocolate shavings, which I am very aware is a child's drink. And at sunrise, it's even on the kids' menu as the Lil Sledder. But the baristas here are usually good about giving me a bigger size and not putting it in the cup with snowmen on it. But since I don't recognize anyone here, it means I'll be able to get my little sledder before my interview, which I take as a good sign. I really don't believe in signs, but you can't grow up with a mother like mine, all crystals and vibes and star charts and manifesting, and not be slightly tuned into them. As I wait, I pull out my flashcards, even though I have all the answers down cold. What year did Fiona Baskin graduate Stanford? Class of 99, double major in history and sociology, minor in theater. What is your proposed area of study? Double major in economics and political science, same as my dad. Why do you want to go to Stanford? I stared down at this card for just a moment. The letters, printed in my neat block handwriting, swirl before my eyes, arranging and rearranging themselves. This isn't a hard one. This should be the easiest answer of all. And of course, I know the answer that is currently printed on the back of my flashcard. The amazing economics department, the campus, the unparalleled access to the top flight faculty, and the opportunity to be surrounded by like-minded students from all over the world. But somehow, the answer that I'm coming up with is what I know is actually closer to the truth. Something like, my dad really wants me to go there, and I think if I went there, it could make things better. It could fix... But I don't know how that sentence ends. All I know, as I take another step forward in the line, is that I have my other answer, my correct answer, ready to go in case she asks me. Next, the barista calls, startling me out of this train of thought. I drop my flashcards in my bag. I spent all last night preparing my answers after all, and with my memory, I don't really have to keep reviewing them. I'm in good shape. Hi, I say as I step forward, zipping up my bag. But then I look up and stop short. There is a barista I've never seen before standing behind the counter. He has tan skin and tawny curls that kind of flop over one eye. He's wearing a long-sleeved Henley under his yellow sunrise coffee apron. The apron has a button on it that reads, "Please be patient with me. I'm new at this." Well, that explains why I've never seen him around here before. I would have remembered him, for sure. I can feel myself blush as I stand there. It's not like I'm indifferent to guys. I've kissed exactly three of them. And while it was fun, none of those kisses felt magical enough to derail my plans. Whenever Brooklyn talks about her guy problems, or Daisha talks about her girl problems, I always listen and try to give whatever advice or support I can, but I'm always secretly relieved that I haven't been wasting my time like that. That instead, I've been studying or volunteering or practicing my lute. Guys have never seemed worth it. But suddenly, as I look at this guy with his curls and his friendly smile, I wonder if maybe that's a policy I should re-examine. "Morning," he says. He gives me a smile that makes me blush more, which is ridiculous. It's his job to smile at people. It doesn't mean anything. "Hi," I say, hoping my face isn't as red as I fear it is. I see that next to his "I'm new at this" button is his name tag. Jonah. "What can I get you?" Jonah asks, already picking up his Sharpie. I freeze, suddenly in the throes of indecision. I really want my hot chocolate. But what if this guy thinks I'm ridiculous for ordering it? But then, why should I care what this guy thinks? Wouldn't I prefer to go into the most important interview of my life armed with the drink I like best? But on the other hand, am I actually going to be able to say the words, "One lil' sledder, please," to a guy this cute? Maybe I can pretend I'm babysitting or something, and I've left the kids in the car? That doesn't seem great. Maybe I can ask for a mocha, hold the espresso. Unless that will lead to more questions. I have no idea what to do, so I decide to stall. I say, I squint up at the board like I'm trying to decide. Let me see. Poppy? I look over and see Merritt, one of my favorite baristas, working behind the espresso machine making drinks. She gives me a nod and picks up a cup. Usual? I nod, relief flooding through me. I got you, she says with a tiny wink. Awesome, I say, giving her a smile. Thank you. Okay, Jonah says. What can I ring you up for? Just ring her up for $4, Merritt says, and I see she's already pumping chocolate syrup into my cup. Jonah nods. Gotcha. I hand over my cash, dropping a dollar and all the change I have into the tip jar, which is shaped like a seashell. Is your drink? He looks around, then drops his voice. A secret? I laugh. No. I can't help but notice how nice his eyes are. They're a dark, foresty green, but with little flecks of gold in them. How do you even describe eyes like that? What does it say on his license? Eye color? Irish meadow? Merritt's just the best at making it. Good to know. I'm still learning the ropes here, so all inside info is appreciated. I noticed, I say, then regret this a moment later. I mean, I noticed that you were new here, because I would have remembered if you had been here before. That's all. Oh my God. Did I just say that out loud? I feel my face flame again. I meant, that's nice of you to say. Jonah replies easily, even as the woman behind me lets out a long, impatient sigh. I'm sure I'll get the hang of learning all the regulars soon. And people have been really welcoming. I even got invited to a party tonight. So everyone's being really nice to the new guy in town. I'm Jonah, by the way. He glances down at his apron and laughs. Which you can see. Jonah liked the whale, right? Well, kind of. It's like a Frankenstein's monster thing. Jonah wasn't the name of the whale. He was the guy eaten by the whale. I'm Poppy. Jonah smiles when I say my name, like it was just the one he's been waiting to hear. Poppy. That's great. Poppy for remembering, right? I frown. Is it? I've never heard that before. Dacia is a fan of cackling poppies at me in her best impression of the witch from The Wizard of Oz, but I've never heard it was about remembering. He shrugs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.